Okay, we here at Piedmont Gardens in Piedmont, California, and we're doing an interview with Sister Samaiyah. So we just want to get a little of her history. She's one of the pioneers from the Nation of Islam, and we just want to make sure we get some of her history of some of the things that she can share with us. So first of all, Sister Samaiyah, I'd like to first ask you, when were you born and where were you born?
I would like to tell you where I was born.
You don't want to tell us when?
I've stopped doing that.
Okay.
You know what? Because I think we remember we talked about that, and you were born in
Oklahoma, and I was born in Oklahoma.
Okay.
And we came here when I was 5 years old to California. My parents, my father had proceeded to come here and establish a residence for us, and then he sent for us, my mother and the rest of the family.
What was your father and mother's name?
My father's name was David George, and my mother's name was Mary George.
Mary, can I tell?
Okay.
Mary Frances George, Mary F. George.
Mary Frances George.
Okay, so did you have any brothers and sisters when you came up? I mean, are you just the only child?
I had seven sisters. I had five sisters and one brother.
Okay, so seven all together with you. Five sisters?
Eight of us.
Eight of them?
Yes.
Okay, somebody's missing.
Eight children my parents had living.
Okay. You just want to know a little bit before you came in the Nation of Islam as a little girl or young teenager. What are there some jobs you had? What was some of your interests as a little girl, you know, as a young girl when you was in Oakland? Do you have certain interests that you enjoy doing?
I virtually grew up in Oakland from the time I was 5 years old until present. I always lived in Oakland, and that's the only place I ever lived was Oklahoma and Oakland.
Okay.
No, I think it was asking too about when you were young or growing up.
Yeah.
Some of the interests that you had, some things that you did, or you know, some things that you remember, say from childhood, that were maybe
Yes. Well, actually, I was always interested in people, and always interested in reading about whatever, anything, and I think that established who and what I am. You know, it had a great deal to do with the choices that I made, some good and some not so good. But at the same time, I was always interested in doing what I was doing rather than just guessing.
Okay. So, were you able to tell me the schools that you went through? Were you able to graduate from high school or what? I mean, remember the first school you went to, elementary and junior high and
I remember my first day of school, which was Prescott Elementary School.
Prescott?
Prescott Elementary
okay.
School.
Okay, that's in West Oakland, right? Okay.
It still exists.
Okay.
And I went to the kindergarten there from kindergarten through the ninth grade at that time.
Oh, Prescott was kindergarten through ninth grade there?
In three kindergarten through ninth grade, Prescott had an elementary school, just out of kindergarten.
Right, right.
And
right.
That's the only education that I had started in Oakland.
Okay, so Prescott, you went to Prescott, and it was from kindergarten to the ninth grade.
My educational
foundation.
That I would say, yes. That I came from, I sprouted from there. Everything that I learned about knowing came from Prescott.
Okay.
Starting with one of the first black teachers that were in any junior high school,
mm-hmm.
or any school in Oakland, but Mrs. I can't think of her name now. Miss Jackson, Ida L. Jackson,
wow.
who is now an icon.
Mm-hmm.
Now let me ask you something. Ida L. Jackson, was she the teacher that my mother, did she ever discuss? I think it was the same one my mother had.
There are records of her. There are records of her all over.
Okay.
Yes,
Ida L. Jackson. Okay.
Because she's a pioneer. Of education in Oakland among mm-hmm. black scholars.
I see my mother had her as a teacher.
So she was one of your mentors. Now,
not so much a mentor as a teacher. She didn't have to do anything but just be around you.
Okay.
And she put imparted part of herself in her students. Mm-hmm. She was a teacher I was very fortunate to have her. She molded a lot of the thinking in my life.
Okay, so now,
Jackson.
So now, after you finished the ninth grade, did you go any further than that, or?
Yes, I went to technical high school.
Technical high, okay.
Down 42nd and Broadway.
Okay, and so did you participate in any sports or anything like that when you was in school?
I played basketball, but not just interstate, grade level. You know, high school.
Oh, interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And keep make sure you look for. Okay.
I played.
So,
I played basketball.
Oh, you did. Okay, great.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we go on a little further. Okay, after you finished high school, did you get any jobs, or can you remember any jobs that you worked on prior?
I remember everything.
Okay. Well, tell us some of the first jobs, remember.
The first job that I ever had, I was for the Department of Agriculture. That was in the first, after I graduated from
high
school.
Mm-hmm.
Let me see, I'm trying to pursue that.
You just remember the ones you remember, whatever one you remember.
Well, yes. Anyway, I went to work very early on. I met a woman who was very instrumental in my continuity to education by reading and by association. And her name was Mrs. Stone.
Okay.
And she was a European,
mm-hmm.
And she took an interest in, she told me that she felt that I was an unusual person, which that was, many people said that about any African American immigrant,
mm-hmm.
who even those brought here by slavery, that were interested in education.
Okay, so now we want to focus on the jobs that you had. Now this
and the job that I had was a decoding decoding what people did numerically.
Mm-hmm.
In other words. It made it into numbers, and that was the first job I had,
okay.
And that was the one that I came out of junior high school with, high school with.
So, look at me more, cause, you know. Okay, so I want to get you.
Oh, okay.
Okay, we can focus on me. Okay. You can look at her. Okay, so this was a job that.
I just said that was my first job.
This was
job.
First job, like, not too long after you got out of high school.
I was like 17.
17, wow. Okay, can you remember anything else after that?
Yes, I did.
Okay,
that was the beginning of my career. The next job that I had
And just give the probably approximately what age or whatever.
The night job that I had was the next job that I had after that was to. Oh, I know. I went down to the Southern Pacific, unbeknownst to my father, and applied for a job down there because they heard that they were hiring students. And when I came home, I was covered with soot from head to toe.
You was covered with what?
Covered with soot, black soot.
The soot.
Before,
okay.
From head to toe. My father said, "Oh my God, mm-hmm. No, no, get those things off of you. I did not send you to school for you to come and down to the Southern Pacific to work." But I was so proud because I was going to be working.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the second job. And mm-hmm. then from yes. then on, the next thing I went, I got a job and I was working for President Roosevelt's son.
What?
Was my right across the aisle from me,
mm-hmm.
at Naval Supply,
mm-hmm.
and he said that was the Navy Club. That was the third job I had.
Wow.
So all my training, but thereafter became part of my education almost, because
mm-hmm.
I didn't have any other education.
So now these jobs that you had, didn't you have to have special training for that? Did you have to go to school for those jobs?
Actually, I don't know. I don't think so.
Okay.
I you had to have a certain grade level,
mm-hmm.
but I don't think you had to have special training such as any degrees of college or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
However, they were all mixtures. Those who had college training,
mm-hmm.
and those who had no more than high school training.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so...
So it was a mixture of people. I was always with people who knew at least as much as I did and possibly much more.
Okay, mm-hmm. Okay, well, so now, is this... Now, any other jobs you remember after that? Is that basically the ones you remember right now?
Say this again.
The jobs, any other jobs after that you remember? Not going into the nation.
All of these have been civil service.
Okay.
And jobs connected with government.
Okay.
Always.
Okay.
That's where I got my basic skills training in delivering, services.
Okay. So tell me this, Sister Samaiyah, now, did you ever get married? Were you ever married?
Yes.
Okay.
I married Robert Bailey.
And when was it? When was this?
In 1937.
Okay. This was before you became, before you came in the nation?
Underage.
This was before you became in the nation of Islam, right? Okay. Okay. And that was your only marriage, right?
That was my only marriage.
Okay.
I had two children of that marriage.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And I had those two, those were the only children that I ever had.
And what were their names? What are their names?
Barbara, Edith, and Adrian, Mary.
Okay, are they still alive? Or?
They're both deceased.
Deceased, okay. So now, well, we're gonna move up to, since we understand you have a lot of civil service job, we're gonna go now to your interest in coming into the Nation of Islam. I understand, I know you had some sister, right, Elretha, right? And I know her husband was Elmer. So let's go through the experience. I know, share that experience of what brought you into the nation first time experience.
Before that,
okay.
I had the experience of having 9 years in Jehovah's Witnesses,
mm-hmm.
Which I have to give credit to. But particularly about the studies of Bible and the more open, more advanced education by being associated and having that experience of being in it's almost a training school, and very very I have to be absolutely certain that's responsible for a great deal of my later achievements and success.
Well, how was your influence with the Jehovah's Witnesses? Was your parents Jehovah's Witnesses, or you just accepted that on your own?
No, I just had contact with them, and I approached. My mother did not insist on religious training for us.
So your mother and father, and, they were
black. They didn't. They were not. They were religious people, but they did not make us go to Sunday school or to church. Okay. We did go, but it was different.
Okay. Okay. So now, you was a Jehovah's Witness for 9 years, you said?
9 years.
Okay. So now, let's go to your experience with the Nation of Islam. You were a Jehovah's Witness. Now, how did you come in contact with the Nation of Islam?
My sister, I was fortunate to come into contact, my first contact being a religious one in the Nation of Islam. And by just helping my sister to proofread some religious, the minister's sermon that he was going to give that Sunday. And that was Minister Bernard Kushmir.
Okay.
And so he gave that, when I got that information, I said, oh, this sounds like the Anointed Remnant. Mm-hmm. That meaning the people in the scripture. You know what the Anointed Remnant is in the scripture, or do you?
Pardon me?
The anointed people, according to Christian faith, were religious people. Mm-hmm. And that's how I started feeling that Islam was more truthful of the history of civilization as it occurred. And I knew about it because I had studied it with Jehovah's Witnesses.
So now, your sister, this material
she was an officer,
secretary?
In the Nation of Islam.
Okay, so you was helping her out with papers. This was before you accepted.
Yeah, as an example.
Okay,
she was younger than me, but she I was older than her.
Okay.
But she was my mentor.
All right. Mm-hmm. Okay, so and she was in Oakland too, right? So now and you said during that time. Who was the first minister? She was working under a minister, Kushmir? What was his name?
Yes, Bernard Kushmir. Bernard Kushmir.
And that was one of the first ministers, right, that you knew of?
Connect that and John Minister John.
Mm-hmm. John Muhammad?
Muhammad. Oh, no. No, he's a young man.
He came after Kushmir?
He just came. He was sent here. They said, by the messenger, and Kushmir came together at the same time.
Okay, I never heard of him.
What year was that in?
Huh?
What year was that in?
I really don't remember accurately, but I'd say somewhere in the 40s.
Okay.
Okay, but you
early 40s.
So you said both of them came at the same time?
Yes, both of them.
Were they both
ministers. Minister John and Minister Kushmir.
I never heard of John. So now.
No, you didn't. He was a self-effacing person.
He was what?
A self-effacing person. He did not try to push himself forward.
Oh, okay. So he didn't last too long, did he?
No.
Okay. So during that time when Kushmir was the minister, that was in San Francisco, right?
We met in San Francisco. We met down on Henry Street.
Oh, Henry.
In Oakland first.
And that, what was it? There was a temple there?
And that was the first place that we had. We're meeting.
So they had
my contact with Islam occurred on the Savior's Day. And at the hall where we were renting, the Muslims were renting. I wasn't a Muslim yet.
Okay.
But it was during the time of Malcolm X, mm-hmm. when the first person I heard of, I guess, of national stature was
Malcolm.
So, and I'm so impressed.
I need to clarify something.
Okay.
So you said your first contact was in the 40s.
In the 40s.
So were you, was El Reef?
60s.
Yeah, I was going to say, because I wasn't born in the 40s and you weren't a Muslim. I know when I was a little girl. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Yeah, but excuse me.
Okay, go ahead. Please.
So it was somewhere 60, in the 60s. Yeah. Okay, I need to clarify that because I knew it couldn't have been the 40s. I wasn't born.
Okay.
And they weren't Muslims when I was a little girl.
Okay, so 50s.
No, 60s. She said it was 60. In the 60s sometimes. Yeah.
Okay, 60s. So you said, now when you was at Savior's Day, this was, where was the Savior's Day convention that you went to? Was it in Chicago?
I came through the scriptural use that the minister had when he taught.
Mm-hmm.
He taught about the 144,000 and so forth and so on. Mm-hmm. And I knew that part of it was accurate.
No, what I was asking you, you said you went to a Savior's Day convention, right? Didn't you say
no,
that? Oh, I did.
The first thing I went was I went down to that Henry Street rented hall.
Okay.
And I got to hear I remember that it was Minister what's that minister's name that used to honor women so much? What's the name's husband? The sister from San Francisco. She was lieutenant one while. Emma.
Okay.
You know who I'm talking about?
I remember that name.
Yeah. So they were in the temple that time, and he was teaching. And when he got to the part that said, I remember the very words. I remember the very words. He said, and what do, when the angel came and met with when the angel came, and said, what do you think he said? He said, Islam, what do you think the angel said?
Uh-huh.
When he greeted him, he said, Assalamu alaikum. And I knew that was fair, because I'd read that in the Bible. Mm-hmm. That is what he said, peace be unto you.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was really, almost everything, the training, the true training that I had gotten,
mm-hmm.
of the Bible,
mm-hmm.
from Jehovah, from being, studying the Bible with Jehovah's Witnesses, mm-hmm. was my foundation. Period, because I learned the truth of it, and now I can be proud and happy that I did, because I didn't learn that truth from what I was taught.
Mm-hmm.
I learned the truth from the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't turn the being the devil and all that. I didn't know that, but I did know truth when I heard it, and I had studied 10 years of Scripture. And it was it had a great influence on my, mm-hmm. my later development.
So you were a student of the Bible. So you read the Bible quite a bit, didn't you?
Yes.
You knew the Bible.
Yes.
So and when you came and heard
and
the teaching.
And I admit the Bible, I could hear it.
You could hear it in the Nation of Islam, the what they were teaching.
Yes.
That's interesting. Okay.
Let me ask you a question. So I know your first contact was with Elretha when you were helping her with some type of paperwork. How long after, the Savior's Day was approximately how long after that?
After what?
After, remember, you said your first encounter with Islam was when you were helping Elretha with the paperwork.
Right away.
Right, it was
right away.
Right away.
Right away.
Oh, okay.
I said that they sound like the anointed remnant.
Yeah.
With you, because they would teach, go to the scriptures.
Right.
For that.
Right.
Mark, in Kashmir.
Did it take much prodding for Elreth for you to come to that meeting when Elreth invited you?
No, it wasn't Elreth. It was Brother Wayman.
Oh,
Brother Wayman
invite. Okay, that's
he was. Family. I was Brother Wayman's convert.
Oh, I see. You weren't your sister's convert.
Yeah, I was Brother Wayman's convert.
Okay.
So now
I had great regard for Brother Wayman.
Okay.
So now you said this the place, the meeting, the place where the Muslims were meeting. It was in Oakland on Harrison Street.
Henry Street.
Okay, Henry. So now. Kushmir was the minister. You remember him?
One of the ministers. That
one of the ministers, yeah.
John and Kushmir.
Okay.
Kushmir later went to prison.
Okay. So now you eventually accepted Islam, and we know during the time you accepted Islam, your name was Olivia, right? You knew his name?
We're talking about a whole world between there.
Oh, okay. Well, we go ahead. We'll go. You can go ahead and you know fill in.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. You, that's a whole another era.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So you started going to the temple, as they call it, on Henry Street.
Yeah, I was going. That's the first hearing I heard, and it was on Savior's Day, because the believers of the temple were away, and that's why this brother was teaching.
Because
the minister, the regular minister, was away at from the mosque.
Oh,
and
I see.
Brother, on Henry Street.
Did you accept right away?
Right away when he said, well, what do you think he said? As-salamu alaykum. Mm-hmm. I was with him all the way. I never said nothing else since.
Now, let me ask you something. Did you ever go back to another Jehovah's meeting after that?
Let me see. I'm trying to remember. I don't think I did.
Okay.
I don't think I ever went back. No. There was a period there where I did not go to the temple or the mosque.
Mm-hmm.
And I had accepted Islam. But I had not manifested any of it, you know, like rewritten a letter and tried it. So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, interesting.
Mm. So now, have you ever met Malcolm X in person?
Yes.
And when was this?
Pardon?
Where and when was this?
I met him at on a number of occasions first. It's hard to remember the first one, but I met him probably in relationship with Aretha and her husband, because they were very active in the community, and that's when I came to hear Malcolm. Malcolm did a lot of home teaching at that time. Mm-hmm. You know, going after the mosque, you know, we went over and to eat. Yeah, well, we ate at the mosque, wherever that was,
mm-hmm.
and we got to hear Malcolm, teach. He was a par excellent.
Mm-hmm. So you actually like sat at the table with Malcolm sometimes.
Oh, yes.
And you said he would give like a home teaching, kind of like when he was at these houses or home when you had a meal, he would kind of teach. There.
He always taught.
Oh, is that
he
right?
Did not stop.
That's interesting. Okay.
Yeah.
So I thought Malcolm was in New York. So he used to come out here a lot.
But he was here at that time.
He
came here. No, he didn't ever. He was never the leader of the mosque in Oakland.
Mm-hmm.
He all we knew was Kashmir.
Right.
But Malcolm was the minister's chief messenger, the messenger's chief minister at that time.
So he used to come to Oakland a lot?
He came to Oakland, and naturally he came to Brother Elmer's house.
Okay.
And that's how I got to know him a little bit more than Muhammad, the one in Los Angeles, the minister of Los Angeles.
Oh,
John. Not
Cream.
Huh?
Mr. Cream? No, not him.
That was way before him. Oh, that was way before him.
I'm
talking about way back in the day.
Oh, back in the day.
Okay.
Yeah.
That was interesting.
But that's when this always said, this is say what in the beginning and probably of the 80s or 90s.
So, now...
No, I don't think I'm getting dates right there, right in there. But the other part is fairly accurate.
So now, your experience, once you said you worked with your sister, did you eventually get a position yourself in the nation as a secretary or anything like that?
I don't know. I don't know that I did.
Okay.
Well, you didn't necessarily have, as time went on, as the years went by, you had certain positions, I think, at the
I did.
You assisted the ministers.
Yeah, I didn't think of them as positions.
Yeah.
But you helped. You helped out.
Yeah, and you helped, you helped in school and quite a bit.
No.
Pardon?
I said you helped in the school.
Well, I didn't help with the school at that time.
Yeah.
See, I was allergic to the school. I was absolutely allergic to the school.
That, how come?
I don't know. I just never wanted to be a teacher.
Okay.
I never wanted to be a teacher.
Okay.
Well, now, Sister Nemat mentioned you, she remembered you, and she said you really took her hands, you know, I don't know, what was that experience with her? I know she was a young girl. So,
yeah, she was. There's a lot of choice at that particular time in her life, and it would have been a lot to her for me to pay any attention to her, because she would be paying attention to me, but I would not be necessarily paying attention to her.
Yeah.
So that's, I think, primarily why she... And of course, you always admire those your elders in any institution.
I want to go back. I know you had mentioned in another interview I did with you that you had you was at Elijah Muhammad's house at one time for dinner or something like that.
I visited him. Only on one occasion I was visited him, and other than, you know, the meetings.
Oh, okay.
I'm trying to think that what they would have been. You know, just more, not the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I met him in person the day that John Kennedy got killed. I met him Arizona.
Yeah.
Arizona, at his home.
So he had another house in Arizona.
Yeah, he had a home in Arizona where he had to stay for his health.
Okay.
Yeah.
So now, how did you end up being there? I mean, he invited you.
I ended up being there and talking with him by myself for about 3 hours.
3 hours. Yes, and share that experience. I know you mentioned it before. Can you tell again? You said that was a day when I think Malcolm got set down. Can you?
What?
When that day that you was there, you said he had received a call.
Oh, yes. That's the day that Malcolm got set down.
And you was at his house.
And I was at the table. We were eating. And the phone rang. And I noticed when he came back to the table to sit down, when he came back to the table, he seemed agitated, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. He felt he seemed agitated because he's a gracious man, very gracious, not anything like you'd imagine. You can't, but he was so gracious and humble.
But you knew something was wrong.
Something was wrong, not right. And that's when I got back to San Francisco a couple of hours later, that I found out that Malcolm had been set down. And then, of course, I knew about that because I was in what you call a laborer at classification.
And that was over the statement he had made about Kennedy, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, and then you mentioned something earlier, I remember last time, about when you got back to San Francisco on the plane, what happened?
Oh, that, when I was first got on the plane, mm-hmm. when I was going to Arizona, mm-hmm. The woman from the Chronicle came and sat in the seat on the plane next to mine.
When you was going to Arizona, you say
I was on my before I was on my way to Arizona that okay. morning, that okay. Sunday morning, uh-huh. and she said everybody was upset about the death of John Kennedy, and of course we had like limelight. The plane was late, mm-hmm. everything because see they had to examine and make sure the plane didn't have any contraband person on it because. Of the situation, you know, and at that time, Muslims were considered to be the contraband, mm-hmm. and so actually, I, just in retrospect, I cannot imagine Malcolm being foolish enough or unlearned enough. Mm-hmm. I put it that way. To make the remarks that are attributed to him. I don't know whether he made them or not. Mm-hmm. About the chickens coming home to roost. Mm-hmm. That was wrong. I was the acting captain, but it was they called it a lieutenant. Mm-hmm. And the at that particular moment, mm-hmm. and I had gone. Oh yeah, so I knew better than to be at least a bit indiscreet, mm-hmm. when I was on the phone, when one of the members called me sisters, and she said, "Have you heard about that devil Kennedy?" Mm-hmm. I said, "I came right down, you know." I said, "No." Mm-hmm. And then because I knew that was the wrong thing to be saying at that time. Yeah. The man just got killed, mm-hmm. and so I didn't say. So that's why I always said, how in the world did Malcolm come to say something like, do something like that at a time like that? He's way too smart. It is all, but you see, he was seduced by the press. That fame seduced. He was seduced by his own fame, and because he's used to being Malcolm, so he's not pleased to be Malcolm. Mm-hmm. But he's pleased that he's so close to the messenger.
Mm-hmm. So now let's go back a little bit when you was mentioning that when you was going on the plane and it was a lady from the newspaper who was sitting next to you.
Oh yes, yes. What happened? Yes, she was trying to bait me in. Mm-hmm. To say something derogatory. Mm-hmm. But this is before any of this other stuff happened.
Before, uh-huh.
In Chicago.
Yes, okay.
And
so she actually...
Because it's Savior's Day, you have to remember. Mm-hmm. So, she said, isn't it awful that all this hate... Now they're getting ready to put this on Muslims. Mm-hmm. All this hate that could causes hate to come into this country, I said, the American people have had a great tragedy.
Mm-hmm. So that's how you responded
yes,
to
sir,
her. So now, during that time, did you have your MGT garment on with the headpiece and everything?
Oh yes.
So you was dressed as a
Muslim. I was fully clothed.
Okay, so she knew you was a Muslim.
No, yeah. Okay. Oh, of course she knows. That's why she sat there. That's okay. why she was pumping. She sat there to pump me.
Okay. So you got on the plane. You made to Chicago. Mm-hmm. We got the information.
Wait, no. Huh? She wasn't going to Chicago. She was going to
Phoenix. Excuse me.
I was on my way to go see
Phoenix, Arizona.
Yeah,
and
Arizona,
they knew that.
Excuse me. Yeah, I'm sorry.
See, they knew all our phones were tapped.
Okay, now... After you got when Elijah Muhammad sat Malcolm down, now you headed back to San Francisco.
Can I ask a question?
Okay, go ahead.
Because you told me you wanted me to ask a question.
Yes.
You know what I want to know is what did you and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad have to eat?
You remember that? That's
interesting. Well, no. It's
that's interesting.
It's part of her story. It's part of the story.
Yeah, that's interesting.
So because you sat for about 3 hours, so
honestly do not remember.
Okay. I couldn't remember that either.
Well, no, because every little detail from what I learned, it's part of the story.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? And I was just kind of curious because if you sit with someone.
I couldn't
say. Okay, that's okay. Cause
but did you get a chance to
excuse
eat?
Excuse me. Excuse
me. Oh, sorry. I thought you was finished.
No, I wasn't because let me breathe.
No appeal.
You and Khalilah are so funny. You and I think this is funny.
We got Khalilah over here. We're going to get her on film in a second.
I don't want to be on film. Right. You can edit me out, but you asked me to be in here.
I'm going to cut all that.
Stop.
Out.
Do it.
Mine
is going to think it's a question.
Go ahead.
I'm a serious
guy. Shut up. Oh, that's y'all so cute.
Anyway, when I hear stories, I love listening to stories, and sometimes it depends on whose company I'm in. I like to tell stories. I really love stories, and so to me, all the little details. Because if you sat with him for 3 hours, so I'm visualizing you guys having people bringing food into the room, and you know maybe drinking some sodas or some orange juice, and you have a spread of food laid out before you, so that was my vision. So if you don't remember,
I don't think it was a special. I just think it was just Muslims ate well at that time,
right?
And that's what they ate.
Right. So you and him.
I didn't pay any attention.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. So are you finished? Anyway.
This in the Arizona, rather than jump here and there. This in the Arizona. So, you can do it if you want to, but after you were there for about 3 hours, mm-hmm. and then you left, and I guess someone took you to the airport. You were taken to the airport.
The chauffeur took me to the airport.
Chauffeur took you to the airport, and then mm-hmm. So how long were you in Arizona all told this for, like, one day? Did you stay?
Oh, no, I didn't spend any night at all.
Okay,
he apologized for not being able to finish that building that they did later acquire in Arizona,
uh-huh.
the what they called the State House at that time, they called it the State House. It hadn't been built, so he said, "I can't." He apologized that he said, "I cannot." And sister, Olivia, I told him, I said, "You sound just like my father." He said, "Oh, where is your father from?" I said, "Alabama." He says, "Oh, quite likely." Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so, that's all he said about that.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Those are little parts of the stories I like to hear.
Spiritually honored to be allowed to see the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
So now, on your...
And talk by myself, with him.
Okay, so now on your return back from Arizona, you're on the plane. So tell us what happened.
Nothing happened on the plane. So I came back, except that the plane, I had to, we did turn around. The plane had to turn around after it took to the air. Mm-hmm. It took back and lined up at the airport, back to the airport. See, we had taken off mm-hmm. for San Francisco.
Right.
The plane had to turn around and come back and land again in Arizona.
Why was that?
And whatever, I never did know why, but mm-hmm. I do know that happened.
Okay.
I never did know why.
So you eventually did get back to San Francisco, right?
Oh, yes, right straight back, the same day.
Did you have any experience when you got back to San Francisco? Anything, anybody talk to
yes.
you there? Look at the camera, Sister Samaiyah.
Mr. John has got
started to courting Sylvia. I had an experience, all right. Aretha had took her in at her home.
What happened?
That's
what happened?
For your ears. Yeah, well, that's for you know, you're on camera.
No.
Yeah, okay, maybe put it by
that. Yeah, but I'm not going into that explanation.
Yeah, don't do that.
Oh, okay. Well, okay, so now, so anyway, would you have any more questions?
I can't think of any right now.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes. Yeah, okay, now. My
you're
question.
So funny. Now, do I have any questions? Well, every time I try to ask something, he cut me off. So you have to shut me down for the moment.
Yeah. You don't need all that.
Samaiyah, look this way. Don't look at her. Look at my camera. Okay, well, I want to ask you now. Okay, we got some of your experience with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. We want to know some of your experience with his son, Ward D. Muhammad. Now, can you share some of that? I know you had some experience with him. Hello?
Yeah. Mike, you have to give the person the time to think. She's thinking what
to my experience was different with his son was not the same. In some ways, I knew a little his son a little better, for one thing. And I've had it more sociable. I could say a social knowledge of him, mm-hmm. even in a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
And it was close, it was very close to our relationship.
Mm-hmm.
When I say close, I don't mean close like love or anything like that. I don't even want to explain that, but it's not that kind of experience. It was just a closer experience because we worked in the community together.
Okay. And
Let me ask.
Okay.
How did you work in the community together? What was your role?
I didn't have a job, but I guess I'd say you'd say that he didn't need me. He didn't need anybody hardly for anything.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Not say that.
Mm-hmm.
Because he didn't need an awful lot. And he didn't spend no time putting something in place. Just like you spoke about people trying to build a record for themselves afterward. He didn't spend no time building a record. That was one of the things that I learned from him. In fact, my character was helped to form by how he told us about his being the things that were not so admirable in his life, and didn't try to make up for it or put a defense on it or put something on it to it that didn't belong there. I had, for the first time, respect as well as religious belief, but more in the line of religious of respect as a human person, just a human person. He's such a respectable human being, but truthful human being.
One other thing, now you also had experience with Muhammad Abdullah, right?
That's right. I didn't realize so. Until now, thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.
I had no idea of the depth of the relationships that I formed as part of my character stuff. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And that didn't seem that important at the time. Not necessarily important, but that were going to influence me, but it was a whole chapter. If I have to, you don't have to go another way. It became a new chapter. I think more honest. Mm-hmm. I was able to become more honest. And it has stayed with me, thank goodness. I don't think it could happen. Made it. I've just charted this with something in my character. Was working for that, looking for that, that somebody to feel straight about. Mm-hmm. Which that so I can speak. I can be honest and comfortable with whatever I say about the good of him. Mm-hmm. Not like a worship or anything, you know.
But you did have personal experience with
him. The only personal experience I had was being the one he selected to be a Secretary of Services.
For Secretary of Services? For Muhammad Abdullah.
Yes. That's okay. And that was to me, and without asking me. Okay. He didn't ask me before, would I do it? He went and asked me at the meeting, would I do it?
No. Yeah. That's great. We appreciate you giving us this interview, Sister Samaiyah. And we have the person that's not on camera that was asking questions was you're a cousin, right?
Yes.
Cousin, that's Sister Kalila.
This is me. Oh, let me back to this. This is a new saying. Back to me. Let me put the camera on me. Back to me. I don't want to put it back on me. I'm just kidding.
No, but she's on.
Yes,
the
I don't need to be on camera. But yes, I am a cousin. Okay. And what else would you like to ask me?
Huh?
What else would you like to ask me?
No, I just basically, you've been cousin, and I don't know the relationship of cousins, but anyway. So, your experience with Sister Samaiyah is you've been
goes back to when I was born, and I won't say the year when I was born.
All these secrets are in the river.
Her mother raised me for the first 5 years of my life.
Uh-huh.
I live with their family.
Okay, great.
She will tell you. She is not. I'm not your grandmother. I am your mother.
This is my. Thank you so much for this interview. May Allah continue to bless you. You're looking well. You're looking so well. I know you don't want to tell your age on the camera.
I can tell her age.
Can
I tell?
Yeah. I want to know how old you are.
Can I tell the age?
If you feel it's your
Oh, okay. Oh, excuse me. It ain't all my privilege. Right. But you can tell everybody.
Well, that's all right.
That's okay.
I learn better, I do better. That's it.
Those of you that's in the sound of my voice, I'll let you know later.
All right. So this ends my interview.
Okay.
All right. So I'm like him.
Peace out. Say, Malik.